is a Garf. These are all extremely good Garfs. It's 2021, the year of the Garf. Orf the Garf. Oh god, no. Well, it's a big... It's got an easy background removable. I should totally make a Garfield version. This is obviously the best body. We are on the search of making the best Garf. There's no bad Garfs, you see. There. I really like this Garf. This is the best Garf. Alright. There you go. So, we are playing the Domino games. Hopefully getting through as many as we can. There's a lot, actually, which is pretty cool. The first one we, of course, played was Garf Maker, the Garf Maker, by Count von Erstaz. I love all of these names quite a bit, actually. It's already max ratings, so that's good. You can tell that's an excellent game. So, there are... 13 games? What? It's ridiculous. Oh, I should follow Domino Club. I am now following Domino Club. So we've played one. I'm gonna try to get to them as many as I can today. If I have to do another day, I totally will. So let's see which one to play next. Let's go in order. That one's probably pretty long, actually. You just missed some Garfs. Nothing big. I'm paralyzed with which one to start for. They all look so good. Let's start with... Okay, Zero Cold. Yeah, that one looked pretty hefty, which I'm really impressed with. Let's start with Paradigm Fetish. Ditherpunk! Oh, that's a great title. Ooh, full screen. Ah! I love a good loading bar. Hello! Oh, this one's gonna actually have sound, isn't it? Let me turn off my lo-fi beats to study to. If I can find where the YouTube video is. Wait, where am I? How am I playing this? There's no windows open. I have made mistakes! Wait, how do I get out of here? Okay, let's go back. I think I... There it is. Okay, now there's no longer two musics playing on top of it. Alright, time to get pegged on the moon, indeed. Right, there, full screen. settings. I always like going into settings, even if I don't like need them. It's always fun to see what people have set for settings. Text speed up, highest. Oh, these little fractional diamonds. Auto speed up. Yeah! I have a little VTuber. And start. Paradigm Fetish, a Domino Club game. Okay, that's just menu button. Made by Hannah Violence. Puzzles. Perp. Woo! Wait, how do I make sure that this that Twitch doesn't demonetize me? Is this gonna be too sexy for Twitch? You know, you can't get hard in 0G. I am digging Purple's vibe right here. Or, well, it's hard to. You lose blood pressure below the waist and testosterone drops. Occasionally, a fellow will be able to if he really concentrates. But for the most part, nuh-uh. So, they send these guys up there for a long-haul missions, and it's like, they're bored all the time, and they can't get off the normal way. Flick guy has nudity. Oh, no. They're frustrated, bottled up, tense. But you know, the miracle of Industrial Revolution is creation. Creating modern tools and solutions for modern problems. So these guys in 0G, astronauts, where it gets around that, hey, you could just buy a synthetic dick, strap it on, peg your way out of the funk. Already the vibes are very good with this one. You just gotta peg your way out of the funk. Or someone else can anyway. My head hurt. I struggled to concentrate on what she was saying as if it was somehow important. She chewed a straw as she talked over the top of her laptop screen. Ear piercing, playing music or stock figures or God knows what. Whilst I sat there tied to the chair, Cyan! How did you get in this predicament? The skipping rope dug into my wrist and chafed as I tried to wiggle. Escape seemed futile, and I was still dizzy with the fear adrenaline. I gave up trying to free my hands and sighed. I thought it was going so well in the bar. You know, depends on what you're looking for. This sounds like it's going pretty well. The woman kept talking as I screwed up my eyes and tried to remember how I got here. Record scratch. I need a little soundboard. So I'm pretty good at identifying what I call a sucker. I mean, a mark, of course. A target. A rube. A man or woman, or neither, with more money than sense. It's the trickle-down economy, baby. Green flowing downhill. It only flows because I kicked over a bucket upstream. Well then, so be it. Really, I think it's morally wrong to possess that much money. Parting someone from their money, why, I'm practically an angel. It's why I don't hang on to it for very long after a successful extortion. I give it back to the community, don't you know? The community being food, wine, and women. The day job pays the rent, and I'm careful to keep all the excess off the books. I don't need some fucking nosy accountant ruining my winning streak. As far as they're concerned, I'm just a lunar meteorological consultant. I clock in, take readings, advise, do my research, clock out, and hit the bars looking for the latest arrivals. People come to the moon for one of several reasons. If they're here to work as a miner, then they'll be on the equator. Either at Reiner Gamma or Grimaldi Base to harvest Helium 3. The scientists tend to be at Tycho for the observatories or Atkin for the geologists. Not that the rockfuckers down at Atkin get much funding. Then there's the tourists, the bougie guys with dashas and sweets. The nouveau riche, splashing their temporary cash on an out-of-this-world vacation. And the supporting class to enable their earth-gazing. That's us at the Pearly Malpert? stable temperatures, Earth line of sight, regions with constant sunlight for power, and the depths of the crater for sleeping and darkness. Greetings! As the moon goes, it's pretty comfy. Of course, $1 trillion will make anyone comfortable. Truly disgusting amounts of money have turned this crater into a luxury destination.
Ah, thank you!
And the tourists have money too. So, yeah, I was in the bar, watching the arrivals. I don't bother with the honeymoon couples. I'm not a romantic or anything. I couldn't care less. It's just not worth trying to extort two people so disgustingly in love. Cyan's a piece of shit and I love them. Love them. I look for solo tourists, businessmen, people I can split off from the group. The best situation is when some company hosts a board meeting here at P-Mal and I can hit several people in 1 week. None of them squeal. Never. I mean, one, if you get it taken advantage of, none of your turbo-capitalist business partners are going to see you the same. Goodbye, negotiating power. All that alpha posturing means nothing if you're the guy who got blitzed on a few martinis and woke up with a lighter wallet. I mean, Cyan is also amazing, too. Besides, half the time it's basically small change I nick. Oop, clicked off the screen. Second, if it's not a simple theft, then I'm doing something like extortion. If you think got robbed while drunk is bad for your marketing cred, try having your piss tape show up in your client's email inbox. Alright. Oh yeah. I'm not above piss. So this stream's going to give a lot of interesting voice clips for me, if anyone for out of context. Just not above the piss. It's not even really my thing, it's just the easiest go-to to film. Sure, it's totally not your thing, Cyan. I don't get why it's such a big deal, really. Everyone pisses. But once I found out that got pissed on by a transsexual and filmed is an embarrassing thing for someone to have leaked, well, golden showers all around, baby. So yeah, that's my operative strategy. One, find a mark. Two, either get him drunk and rob them, or seduce and fill us doing something on the scandalous side of the kink line. If they're monogamously married, then I don't even have to piss on them. Rinse and repeat. Well, if you're pissing on them, I sure hope you do rinse. Thanks. Okay, I'm back on track. I remember what happened. That's her, fresh off a transfer shuttle from one of the orbital stations. Expensive flowery business suit, implants, suitcase on wheels. Wheels are such a giveaway. Like, the gravity here is low enough to make wheeled suitcase unmanageable. The banter's very good. They bounce all over the place if you don't control them, let alone zero G. Wheels are just completely useless there. So yeah, this woman looks like she has money, and maybe she isn't the most wise to lunar extraterrestrial situations, and she's alone. Granted, I usually target guys, but I'm not picky. There's just more of them, and they're so full of shit they're usually easier. I have to be a bit more careful with the women, but my radar's usually good. I'd never been beaten yet. Fucking the dither so good. I had barely gotten off the shuttle when this guy came up to me at the bar. Hey. Like I still had my suitcase. He was that immediate. Not like I'd been letting my suitcase out of my sight. I knew from the moment he opened his mouth that he was exactly the type I like to twist around my finger. Cocksure and arrogant, with some ulterior motive. I wasn't sure if he wanted to fuck me or con me. Not that it mattered. I don't think he knew at first. But the one in control was me, right from the start. All the questions he asked about why I was here, I gave convincingly bland answers to. If he was trying to con me, then I should keep my cards to my chest. And if he was trying to fuck me, I wanted to be able to mess with him. And when I mess with people, I don't like them to be able to track me down afterwards. Not that he would be able to track me down. I let him think it was his idea that we went back to my room. At no point did he clock that I was specifically here on this dumb fucking moon because of him. Like, it took me maybe 5 minutes to figure out that this was his target, and he must have been so high on his own juice, he thought I was into him. Ugh, gross. I could feel his fucking drool on my neck already. Smart guy didn't try anything in public, or else the assignment would have gotten a lot messier. But when he tried for a kiss in the doorway to my room, I made a got your nose gesture with my left hand, and the hidden tranquilizer needle shot into his neck, asleep before he hit the floor. Ooh, intrigue. My head pounded. I struggled to open my eyes and felt them heavy, as if I had not slept in a week. When I tried to rub them, I couldn't move my arms. That was enough to force them open a fraction. I was tied to a chair with something. Skipping rope? Good morning, boy. I blinked at the voice and looked around for it. A few meters away, the woman from the bar was hunched over a laptop, the screen glinting off a pair of data glasses. Ooh, data glasses. No, that wasn't right. Her pose was absolutely not hunching. It was too confident for that. That kind of disgusting, avert-friendly, corporate aspirational aura radiated off her like a perfume. She looked up after a second, smiling scarily, and took her glasses off. Nothing to say. I'm processing that. Okay, done processing. Why the fuck am I tied to a chair with skipping rope? Because that's what I had to hand. I skip for exercise. That's not what I meant. She stood up and took a few steps towards me, stopping up to my side. Close enough to feel her breath, then she leaned down and touched her fingers to my cheek. You have no idea why I'm here, do you? What? You've been a bad boy, Cyan. Why don't we skip the dancing around and you admit it? I felt a flush of fear and tried, as best as I could, to tamp it down while still totally helpless. I don't know what you mean. Tam tam tam. The woman licked my... Woo! Perp! The woman licked my ear, tracing her tongue slowly from lobe to tip. I tried to recoil away and only managed to lean a few inches from her. She remained where she was, talking to my left ear. Do you know what card counters are? Yeah, math guys who try to play the poker by tracking card numbers. She laughed then, a deep and throaty laugh with sharp edges. Of course you know one crook for another. The great hubris of card counter is to think that they can win against the house. Perhaps they really can, with luck or a lot of care. But it doesn't matter. Because the house is rigged? No, it doesn't matter if the house rigs the games or not. She takes a step round to my front and sits on my lap, straddling me. Get off me! Do you know what it doesn't matter? I don't care. Stop talking about card counters and untie me. You should care. This concerns you. Why does it concern me? Because when someone wins against the house breaks their legs. My stomach went cold. Do you have a favorite finger? Wow, perp! Woo! What? Which one do you want me to break first? I don't. Stop. What do you want? Money? I have money. Choose, you fucking dog. Pick a hand, left or right. She stared right into me, her eyes wide, and now I realized, absolutely fucking crazy. Down by my side, she traced one hand down to each arm, curling around my wrists. Okay, I've decided. Right hand. Index finger. No, please don't. Here we go. I squeezed my eyes shut in horrified anticipation as her hand closed around my index finger. Then I hear a sharp crunch and yell. It doesn't hurt at first. I'm numb. Then it still doesn't hurt. I open my eyes and she's holding a cheap biro in front of my face. Biro? Is that a lighter? I think that's a lighter. In front of my face, snapped in half. The plastic splinters like a glass where she's broken it in two. The ink inside... Oh, it's a pen! Biro... Yeah, okay. The ink inside's starting to leak. Just kidding. I'm not gonna break your fingers. What the fuck? I think you would scream too much and I don't like that much noise. No? So what if I scream now? Will you? I considered it. It felt... I wasn't sure if I could. Are you embarrassed, perhaps? You fear what will happen if someone comes through that door and finds you tied to a chair, after what is clearly a tryst with a woman you tried to pick up right in the CCTV view. Maybe I'd even piss on you. Imagine what it'd do to your reputation. They were reading the same playbooks. Suddenly, I feel my stomach churn as a shoe dropped. She knows all about the extortions, the people I've been scamming. This is why she's here. This is retribution. The game is up. She sits back on my lap and leans past my head to whisper in my ear. So, let's talk, Cyan. I gave up. What do you want me to talk about? She let out a breathy laugh and clasped her hands to my shoulders, pushing back from me and standing up. So many things, Cyan. Which is great, because we have a fair bit of time to pass. I do hope you're fun to talk to. She crossed the room and sat back behind her laptop again, waking up the screen with a flick of her fingers. Then she leant back for a moment and looked at me, thoughtfully. A minute passed and I could see cogs turning behind her eyes. What? What are you thinking? I just want to say I really, really love how the characters move around the screen. I don't see that super often in visual novels, and it gives a really, like, cool, dynamic thing to it. Sorry. She smiled. Floodgates opened. You know, you can't get hard in zero G. Oh, it's back to pegging. So there we were, back where we started. What had begun as fear had turned into bemusement. What sort of person ties you up only to talk about men having sex with men and threaten to break your fingers? Several people I know, actually. I regretted my attempt to target her in the bar. Perhaps if I had the ability to go back in time, I would warn myself to get out before she arrived. Warn myself to get out before I got tied to a chair and had to listen to her monologues. So, like, these guys are up there and pegging's on the agenda. Domino Club! It doesn't matter how. Whether they came up with it or someone suggested, that's not important. But right here, here's the twist. The guy wants to get off, right? But he can't get hard, so he's thinking about pegging instead. Couldn't they just use a vibrator? Huh, you find me a guy who thinks about vibration before he thinks about penetration. But here's the thing. The guy doing the pegging, wearing the strap, whatever, he's not going to get much from it. He's not going to get that release. Maybe he'll get off a bit. It's not unknown. But most of the time, he's going to be letting the other person get off. So this is, like, a two-for-one switch. It's decoupling the man from my pleasure-first mindset. It's making him think, hey, maybe I want to be getting penetrated. Maybe I should. Of course, it's, like, taboo to him, so he's going to tie himself in knots. You're all really struggling under this weighted blanket of heteronormativity. I'm not heteronormative. You can peg me. Wow. Just untie me first and we'll work it out. Shut up. Nice try. You've thrown me off my rhythm. Where was I? You were monologuing about pegging for 20 minutes. You're obsessed. Oh yes. Is that so bad? I find it deeply fascinating to think about. Of course, I find it enjoyable to be the one wearing the prosthetic, but more than that. The lengths that straight-identifying men will go to self-rationalize their burgeoning sexual liberation as they are liberating in turn from the gravity of the earth. Don't you think it's beautiful and sexual? I love those eyes. The chat's killing me. This is funny. Of course it's sexual. Shut up. I don't mean the act itself. I mean the mental gymnastics. These straight guys reorienting their sense of what they want and desire and physically crave. Woo, candle! Woo! Woohoo! A total shakeup of their social order as they crumble one by one, and the desire for pleasure wins out over their desire to be the one penetrating another. This is what get me off. Paradigm collapse. Melting and reforming. Do you know how to temper chocolate? Woo, purple! Perp, your mind! It's all over! I don't know what that means. Is the chocolate angry? Chocolate has multiple crystalline forms, but one of them is objectively superior. To get it to form in this way, you have to melt it and let it cool at specific temperatures, breaking down its previous form into a controlled way to shape it into something desirable. And you're going to say guys are like this. You get it now. I'm talking about tempering men. They're not so predictable as chocolate, you see. Each one has their own temperatures you have to raise and lower them to. Their own highs and lows and contexts they have to go through to come around to penetration. I'm not really sold on this. I don't think every straight man is going to be into it. Clearly, you haven't found your own process. Do you feel scared by the possibility? Intimidated by it? This was ridiculous. You're so obsessed with this idea of men tackling some innate fear of penetration. Well, guess what? I have a cunt. I know penetration. I may be quite reasonably unnerved by you trying to tying to a chair and threatening to break my fingers, but your monologue about pegging is just quaint, nothing else. She stood silently for a moment, derailed. What? Didn't know. Didn't do your research. You're trans? That complicates things. I'm gonna have to process this. Surely it's not a novel idea to you. Don't tell me you're a transphobe. No, the opposite. I won't kill trans people. That's praxis. ... You were going to kill me? She just looks at me, disapprovingly. You hadn't figured that out yet. You've made Marana Group very upset with your extortions. When large conglomerates have problems, I solve them. Now I need to figure out how to solve you instead of just stuffing you into the biomass recycler. Solving problems for big businesses. What a wonderful little capitalist you are. Do your shoulders get wet when all that wealth trickles down on you? She rolls her eyes. The thing about capitalism is that little lefties are always like, ooh, wealth is so unbalanced, the system doesn't work at all. Actually, it works perfectly for what it's designed to do. There's a winner and a loser, and though you fancy yourself otherwise, you are a loser. I'm quite comfortable with my position higher in the food chain. I bet you are. Late-state capitalism is a game, a dance. There are rules to learn and follow and break. This is just Machiavelli for women! I'm exceptionally good at learning systems and rules. I also largely don't care what happens to losers. They die, they go bankrupt, they sell their organs to afford rent. It's natural selection. Such a bleeding heart you are. How do you sleep at night? Very well. Money can buy a good pillow. She sighs again, as if this whole enterprise is thoroughly difficult. I struggle against the skipping rope again to no avail. So, what happens now? You gonna let me go because I'm trans? And what's with that anyways? Are you a chaser? Is this some pity play on me? No, you asshole. I'm trans too, in solidarity. I stare at her for a moment. Then I slowly and deliberately spit on the floor between us. Keep your solidarity. I don't want it. Lips that touch capital will never touch mine. I didn't say anything about lips. You're getting ahead of yourself. And besides, do you really think you're any different? A con man versus a capitalist? I just have the weight of a corporation behind me. And that lets you go around and kill, does it? At least I steal a bit. Sure, might makes right and lets me sneak and steal and learn and play. I'm not a contract killer. I handle all kinds of problems. She picks up the straw from her drink again to chew on it. Smoker? Missing a fag? Yes, I want to wrap this up so I can go smoke. That's why there are only three smoking areas and this whole base escapes me. Oh, why there's only three smoking areas and this whole base escapes me. Probably because it's frowned upon. Just like tying up and threatening and murdering guys is frowned upon. So is extorting them out of money. Don't try and get the moral high ground on me. The only difference between us is how often we win. Oh no, they're both British. She stops them and frowns inwardly, suddenly lost in thought. I don't like where it's going. Are you happy? What? Am I happy? No, right now I'm definitely not happy. I don't mean right now. Are you happy with your life? Do you feel content with your day-to-day? Why do you care? Suddenly developed a conscience? I figure you're probably not. Where do the cons and extortions come from? Boredom with the day-to-day? I can't imagine being a lunar meteorologist is particularly exciting. Actually, it can be. You'd be surprised with- No, fuck you! I'm not doing this! I refuse to let you psychoanalyze me. What are you going to do? Give me career advice? I was thinking of it, yes. You clearly enjoy deceit and the exercise of power. What do you get in the moment? Does it excite you? Would you live a life where that pursuit was your everything? My mind raced. She wasn't wrong, which was the thing I hated most. I enjoyed the feeling of power when I pulled off an extortion, of feeling someone buckle underneath me and give in. It wasn't about the money, really. It was about breaking someone. Someone who thinks themselves too powerful to be a victim. Really, if she hadn't got one over on me first, she was exactly the kind of person who'd be the most fun to win against. So overconfident and full of herself. I wondered what she'd be like if she lost, what the expression on her face would be. I wanted that, suddenly. I wanted to win right in front of right from this position here, tied to a chair and monologued at. Okay. Oops, clicked off again. So maybe I do enjoy it. But it's not like I'm indiscriminate. I only target people who have it coming. And in your eyes, that's rich people. Businessmen? Yeah, they're not going to miss it. And they probably got rich by exploiting others anyways. And so the chain goes on. Your trickle-up justice is because you perceive someone as breaking some social rule. You justify it as them being somewhat deserving. And so you rob them, extort them, blackmail them. Really just give Perp a little bit of leeway and she's going to monologue. Yes. She claps her hands together with a satisfied smirk. So we're the same. Every problem I solve, people or systems, is deemed to break the proper order of things. Grit in the gears of corporations, and I'm compressed air. Well, you certainly have a lot of wind. We're not the fucking same. No. Why? Just because we have different collections of beliefs? Because you think you're morally pure being a crook on this side of the axis? We even have the same targets. Do you think I bother with anyone who isn't already rich or powerful? My employers don't care about the Poliariat. They mean nothing to the machine. 9 times out of 10, our targets are the same. She leans in close to me and cups my chin in her hand, lifting my head to look her in the eye. If we're already so close, you might as well just join me. Join you? Some operations are easier with a partner, a distraction, or a double team. She talked about picking again? Or just a tougher pair of hands. I'm not as strong as I used to be. No, absolutely not. In what fucking world am I joining you? She simply shrugged. My client wants you out of the picture one way or the other. This is the simplest, and every other option gets progressively worse for you. The choice is yours. Epilogue, ooh. I dig my toes into the sand and feel it warm beneath them. Fresh air, unlimited sky, the sound of whatever bird survived the warming climate here. Peach episode. Behind me, Cyan carries our suitcases, only half mindful not to drag them through the sand. It's not that important how I convinced him to join me. The details aren't so interesting as the effect. I know he's planning to get one over me. Perhaps he thinks he can win permanently and not just temporarily. It's quite exciting to have that ambient threat. But for now, he plays along. We are here to eavesdrop on a board meeting held in the beach resort. It's practically a holiday. No one to kill, this time. Nor even threaten. Simple corporate espionage. Frankly, it's almost boring. But I am saved from that fate by my new accomplice. He's so fun to wind up. I think he's still pretending to himself that he doesn't like me. I wonder how long he'll be able to keep up that lie. But I haven't pushed that sore spot just yet. He's given me enough excitement already to spectate this great contextual shift, watching him fall from Robin Hood to Cog in the machine of capital. Every time I push him further into this new identity, I feel a shiver. I don't think he's ever got it, back in my hotel room in Pearly Malpert. For all he went on about me monologuing about pegging, he's wrong on what I like. It's not pegging I care about, really. It's paradigm change. I have a fetish for the breaking down of the old order, the formation of the new. Liquid poured into a new receptacle. Transition. He called me a chaser, and he's not wrong, really. That moment where the old rules are broken and the new ones haven't been found. Liquification. Liquid chocolate waiting to crystallize. Desperate to know what form it will take. Whether it will snap or melt or shine. Yay! Alright, that was fantastic. Those characters are extremely fun. Content warnings for threat. Content warnings for capitalism. Yeah, the character art is absolutely fantastic, too. Very good job by your niece. Alright, so which one to do next? Might as well continue going in order. Actually, the instruction manual is an homage to a tale of the same name by Julio Cortazar. I'm not familiar. Wait, they're not all horny? I was lied to. I thought all of Domino's was hornies. Up to and including the Garfield creator. It was created by the pursuer and a lady from Paris for Domino Club Jam. It's made from Bitsy. By Adam Ledoux, with Hacks from Sean, and Pixie by Ruin. The instruction manual. Oop, no sound on this one, so I am going to attempt to bring up that. Okay, there it goes. Actually, let me open another one. Sorry about this. I'm a professional. I just can't stand when there's no audio. Here. It's a playlist called 2 Hour Synthwave Mix. Ooh. Yeah. I noticed that my keyboard's loud enough to make my avatar talk. Haven't quite figured out how to fix that yet. Oh, you know I'm horny for skeletons and nuclear waste. Okay. Preamble to the instructions on how to have sex in space. I don't know. We're looking a little sus here. Look like a little astronaut. Think of this. When they present you with a device for performing sexual duties in space, they are gifting you with a tiny flowering hell, a wreath of roses. A dungeon of air. I really, really love the stars and the rocket. They aren't simply wishing the device on you, and many more. And when you hope it will last you, it's a good brand, Swiss. 17 credits. They aren't just giving you this minute stone cutter, which will bind you and walk along with you. They are giving you, they don't know it, It's terrible that they don't know it. They are gifting you with a new, fragile, and precarious piece of yourself. Something that's yours, but not a part of your body. That you have to strap to your body like your belt. Like a tiny, furious bit of something hanging onto your crotch. So, all these are going to be about pegging, right? They gift you with the job of having to wind it every day. An obligation to wind it, so that it goes on being a device. Ooh. Ooh. I like that piece of wordage. They gift you with the obsession of looking into outer space to calibrate the device. Check the radio announcer. Check the comm service. They gift you the gift of fear. Someone will steal it from you. It'll fall in the street and get broken. They give you the gift of your trademark and the assurance that it's a trademark better than the others. They gift you with the impulse to compare your device with other devices. They aren't giving you a device. You are the gift. They're giving you yourself for the device's birthday. Ooh. Oh, the word. Oh, the language in this is so good. Instructions on how to have sex in space. Death stands there in the background, but don't be afraid. Ooh, I didn't think about the DMCA. Hold the device down with one hand. Take the stem in two fingers and rotate it smoothly. Now another installment of time opens. Trees spread their leaves. Boats run races like a fan time continues filling with itself. And from that burgeon, the air, the breezes of earth, the shadow of a woman, the sweet smell of bread. What did you expect? What more do you want? Oh, this is cool. Oh, I really like this. Quickly, strap it on. Let it vibe away in freedom. Imitate it greedily. Fear will rust all the rubies. Everything that could happen to it and was forgotten is about to corrode the device's veins. Cankering the cold blood and its tiny rubies. And death is there in the background. We must run to arrive beforehand and understand it's already unimportant. Oh, and death is there in the background. We must run to arrive beforehand and understand it's already important. Oh, is this the end? We're in space now. Death is here, apparently. I have not actually played too many bitsies that don't have an end, and this is really intriguing. Ending on the screen without resetting is actually a really cool vibe. Well, yeah, we'll have to sit here for the actual time it takes to get to the moon for the secret sex. It's just like Jonathan's Blows game. It's really good. All right. Party if pandemic events. Uh-oh, this one's not playing browser. Yeah, this is just a prequel to Paradigm Fetish. A party by Diggity Dog. Oop, this one's got music. Or should we mute this music so we don't get content created? Content something? We'll see. Oh, yes, absolutely. Well, I don't want someone to block our video, so. I'll just have to sing the tracks. You know what? We'll just see. We'll see. We'll see if you get through. If one day pandemic ends, Zony's party? Whoa. Yeah. This is so good. This has got so many good vibes to it. That's great. This is so good. Okay, love the hair here, actually, quite a lot. Yes. Straight up party. Yes. Whoa. Yeah, it's absolutely gonna get muted or whatever. I don't even care. How many rooms are here, actually? Okay, the fact that the audio didn't load for this is really funny to me. It's all playing at once. Okay. think we... Oh, I missed Gray. Miss Gray. Where's Gray? Oh! No? I think I got that one. Okay. I think I got them all. That was amazing, though. Oh, blue again? I think I need to click blue again. Oh, yeah, obviously. Okay. That's really great. Ah, this is the one that I missed. Wow, that was excellent. That was so, the vibes on that one were so good. We are all but bones and dust. Now we're something completely different. Ooh. Hey, comment on it. Yay. Ooh. Ooh, I love this. CWS. Oh, context warnings. The tone of this game is light, but the nature of the characters, skeleton, results in a discussion of death and related concepts. It also includes flashing lights. I don't think we need more specific. These games don't have achievements because they are achievements. Who are you? Me? I'm bones and dust. I'm decomposing calcium. I'm sandy loam. I'm trying hard. I'm just a little guy. I'm lactose intolerant. I'm walking over here. I'm bitten bogus. I'm the most fuckable person in this dump. I'm sorry, I'm walking over here. The keeper looks down at you without interest. Oh. Oh, the vibes are good. Yeah, like, aren't we all? Aren't we all? And what do you want over here? To go for a stroll? To see the sights? To live a little? Ah, a ghosting then. Yeah! Let me just check your record. About that. Yes. Never mind. It says here, walking over here finished their unfinished business roughly 3 years ago. What if I have new business? Do you? Maybe. No, you don't. I might. No, you don't. Fine, I don't. You know the rules as well as I do. Nobody is to leave the boneyard. With only the following exceptions. Permitted accompaniment from authorized travelers. 2. Resurrection and or thermatological summons. 3. Unresolved taxes, trauma, or equivalent material manifestations. Mind Mien. Four. Not dead. Oopsie. But I've been summoned. But I need to pay my taxes. But I'm not dead. I'm so bored, but it's Halloween! I love that there's more exclamation parts each time, but clearly it's because it's Halloween.
No, it isn't. It's not even October.
It's Halloween, baby!
No buts. Walking over here, you are alone.
Rude.
There have been no divine interventions on your behalf. Your taxes are paid, and your trauma is immaterial, buried deep within the recesses of your mind's eye, where none but you may wear its witness.
Rude!
And finally, you are very dead. Now be gone.
All right, I guess I'll be gone. Ooh. This is great. I love being a skeleton. The flickering dither on this is real cool. Ooh. Oh, I love being in a grave. Ooh. Hmm. Oh, gotta use my mouse. New flesh? No, I lived here a while. Have we met? Are you offering some new flesh? No. Do you have any? I'm all out. We are skeletons. How do they expect me to work like this? You know what? We're dead right. That's the problem. I'm a marvelous artist, you know. Sure. A genius in the flesh. Uh-huh. But what does that mean here? No flesh. Did they expect Michelangelo to sculpt without stone? Or Donatello? Raphael? Da Vinci? Exactly. Ooh, this is so good. Hello, Mr. Ibe. Take that bucket. Give me the bucket. I can't take the bucket. Hello? A customer? I don't know what this person's voice or the skeleton's voice should sound like, but it's clearly tiny and excited. One moment, please. Oh, pushing me. Ahem. Welcome to your one-stop shop for shades and stains. I would like to buy a stain, please. What is this? This? My shop! Shop? Dyers for dyers! I make dyes. Dyes? Dyes? Okay, bye. Only a fool sees the world in black and whites. And why? Care for a change of perspective? How much does it cost? Cost? Yeah. Well, we're dead. But you said this was a shop. Yes! A dye shop. Would you like one? Sure. Which one would you like? Jokerify me, baby. Bam. That's what I like to hear. Ooh. Ooh, those are some colors. Hit me again. That's what I like to hear. Yeah! Ooh, I like this. I'm good. Come again! Can I have your mine? No. Want to go ghosting? No. They don't like it when they put dyes in their eyes up there. Fair enough. Let me go back to this. Oh, are you still here? What's the deal with this flesh? You're curious about my art? I surface the true potential of flesh as canvas. Oh, a worm? Tattoos! Can I get one? I did mention the lack of flesh, yes? What if I got you some? If you could, I would be very grateful. Cool. Gotta find some flesh. Hey, do you have any flesh? Hey, do you have any flesh? Oop, push me into the store. Ooh. Is there any flesh over here? Woohoo! Are you okay? Boo-hoo-hoo! Boo-hoo! I'm dead! We're all dead. Boo-hoo-hoo! Anything I can do to help? No one can help me! Wah! I miss them so much! I didn't even get to say goodbye! Oh, boo-hoo! Boo-hoo-hoo! I bet they do want to go ghosting. But I want to see more things. Whoa! You approach the maimed body. Hello? Hello. Well, what? What's your name? Introduce yourself. Is this a joke? No? Well then, it's nice to meet you walking over here. What can I do for you? Can I have your mine? My what? Your mine. Oh, is that mean? Mine? Mean? My mean what? No, not like that. I mean like your face. Excuse me? I like the material manifestation of your living karma bound to your body in death. I'm going to stop talking to you now. They do their best to ignore you and avoid eye contact. Rude! This has got lore. Oh, hello there, fairy circle. Please, mind your steps. Some of these plants are very delicate. Oh, sorry. You approach the floral figure. Hello there. What can I do for you? Can I have your mean? Oh, haha. I'm afraid it's not that simple. It takes many years of study and practice to cultivate knowledge like mine. It's me. Tell me, are you a fellow student of the horticultural sciences? I could be. Wonderful! Feel free to come with me at any such questions you might have. I don't have a curriculum prepared, of course, but I'm always happy to help another in the pursuit of knowledge. Yeah, this one is actually just me. I'm in the flower circle now. Oop, don't push me into the flowers. There's so much to this one. I'm really impressed. I have quests even. Oh, you're just another skull man. Still trying to ghost without a reason, huh? Oh, rude. I thought I saw another one out there. Maybe not. Nice. going to find the sad. Nope. Want to go ghosting? Nope, nope. Select the wrong one. Bloop, bloop, bloop. They blow their nose. Oh, that was a sound. Furiously and continue sobbing. You could maybe go say goodbye? Maybe. You'll come with me? Of course. Okay. Yay! I have a friend. You approach the keeper's gate once more.
Walking over here, what is... Oh, you're actually accompanying someone. Are they okay?
I'm helping.
If you say so.
Yeah. You pass through the gates, unimpeded by the keeper. You take the lead of your sorrowful companion as the two of you make their way through the dead of night. You pass row upon row of dirty gray houses, deep in some ramshackle of a suburb. Eventually, you reach a little bungalow with a bright blue door. Well, everything's a little blue. There's a pickup truck in the driveway, and a light shines through a window. You sneak around back and climb over the fence in your yard. In the yard. Ooh. Let's go haunting. They pause when you reach the house. What's up?
I think I'd like to do this bit alone.
Wait outside. They open the door and enter. There's not much to do out here. You kick at the dirt and practice your death rattle. That's what I'm always doing that. Eventually, they return. They're gone.
What do you mean? They weren't there. No one was. No one I recognize, at least.
Oh. Well, did you get a good spook in, though?
Everything's different. Why is it so different? I miss my life. I miss my home. And I knew I wouldn't be getting those back, but I just wanted to say goodbye.
They don't answer. Well? You pause at the fence. Just as you are about to leave, a muffled sound catches your attention. What was that?
Oh my god. Quick, we have to dig her up.
In a few moments, you've excavated a body. She purrs and rubs against your sullen friend. Is that a dead cat?
Oh, Miss Skittles, I've missed you so much. I'm sorry I've been gone so long. But I'm here now, it's okay.
They scoop up Miss Skittles and cradle them like a baby. The bony feline's front paws stretch out, lazily clawing at the air as they relax into embrace.
Do you think... Okay, I know I just wanted to say goodbye, but do you think we could take her back?
She's dead. We're dead. It could work. I don't see why not. Yee! They hop back over the fence, but you hang back.
What's the matter? Aren't you coming?
I just have some stuff to take care of.
Oh, okay. Well, before I go, I just need to say thank you. Thank you so much. I never would have done this without your help.
Walking over here, you're the best dead friend I've ever had. They turn their attention to the cradle cat. Except for you, of course. They wave and take off, leaving you in the yard. You watch them walk away and disappear into the suburban sprawl. Alone at last, you get to work. You saunter up the small open grave and you continue digging. The soil is tough and dry, but you slowly make progress, widening it, deepening it, until it is roughly large enough to fit a human body. You climb in and begin filling it back in around you. This is going to be so good. The ground is cool as it envelops your limbs, fills your ribs, covers your face. You imagine the look on someone's face when they unearth you. And you wait. The end. We're all but bones and dust. Presented by the Domino Club. That is amazing. Wow. You died. This is really good. I want to play through it again. It looks like there might be more endings or branches. I'm going to play this one on my own time. But man, really good. Oh, there are more endings. Good. I love the vibes on it. What was this made in? Also, a link to go back to the page is really good. Does it say? If you go ghosting with a different ghost. I'm assuming you have to, like, convince a few of them. Kind of want to go back. I know there's more ones to play, but I want to know... Who am I? Obviously, I'm Bitten Bogos. The keeper looks down at you without interest. PixHJS. Because this was really good. Yeah, aren't we all? Aren't we all? And what do you want, Bogos? Live a little. So then, go ahead. It says here, Bitten Bogos finished their unfinished business roughly 3 years ago. But you know the rules as well as I do. Alright. Just gonna... But I need to pay my taxes. No buts. Bitten Bogos, you are alone. Bogos meant it? Alright. Yeah. I do love to hack death. Okay, so we went ghosting with that. With them. I wonder if we'll find some flesh. So there's the flesh artist. Or tattooist, actually. Me? I make dyes. Dyes? Dyes! Only a fool sees the world black and white. Want to go ghosting? No, they don't like it when you put dyes in their eyes up there. Fair enough. I want to go ghosting. Have your mind? Nope. Oh. Ooh. I like that these... I would like to do crimes. Yeah, this is the crime colors. Thank you. Come again. Wondering if I don't weird this person out. Hello. Well, what's your name? Introduce yourself. Is this a joke? No. Well then, it's nice to meet you, Bitten Bogos. Wanna go ghosting? You're quite forward, aren't you? Is that a yes? I must say, I knew some boars in my time, but at least they asked my name before propositioning me. Sorry, you're right. Then would you care to explain yourself? I want to explore the realm of flesh with you. I would like to be your accompaniment. Look, if you're asking me on a date, I'd prefer if you just came out and said it. I am asking you on a date. Well, I normally wouldn't do this, but I must admit there hasn't been much excitement of late, and I happen to be in need of an escort for tonight. You understand that discretion is the utmost importance, yes? Discretion is my middle name. Let's be off then before I change my mind. Hey! Yay, we're getting another ending. It is a date with a maned skeleton. It's just what I always wanted. You approach the keeper's gate once more. They ignore you and instead address your companion. Any game that where you get to say your middle name is something and it changes your middle name to that is a good game. I'm just saying. Ah, off on another of your
consultations. Hush you, you must really be hurrying along. You're permitted to leave, don't let me stop you. But don't blame me if you get in trouble. Ooh, trouble. Oh no! Poor cat. You pass through the gates, unimpeded by the keeper. You're surprised at how efficient your companion is. Not minutes after having left the boneyard, they march straight into the open and flag down a long, sleek vehicle. It's a bold approach to ghosting. Definitely not your style, but you're curious how it will play out. It seems that spooking the driver isn't their intention, though. Before you process what's happening, you've been ushered into the back seat, and the two of you are being taken for a ride. Isn't the driver scared? James? Of course not. You're not scared of little old me, are you, James? The driver raises a hand in acknowledgement from the front seat without taking his eyes off the road. He's been on retainer with the family since before I died. I'm told the estate still pays him well. So, bitten discretion. Oh, it did! Oh my god, it did! Woo! Oh, this is the game of the year. Absolutely. Best thing. Have you been to the one of the parties before? You soon find out what they mean. Ooh. Okay. Getting kind of eyes wide shut. Yes, I've taken up bleaching as of late. Does wonders for the complexion. I hear they have a new cook. Tragic incident with tipped refrigerator. Great luck for us. It's been ages since anyone with 3 stars died. You're buried where? Goodness. Oh, that's my companion. I'm trying to talk to the person following me. No, heavens no. Wouldn't want to be caught dead with her. Oh, don't look so gloomy. Just because we're dead doesn't mean we can't live a little. You're buried where? Goodness. Oh, the chat's so full of people. Hello. Everyone's throwing shade at where I'm buried. I'm just here for the food. You mingle for a bit, your date making a point of introducing you to multiple people, whose names you forget immediately. After a few hours of idle chatter and finger food, you're taken by the arm and led through an arduous goodbye, eventually leaving the party. I had fun. Did you have fun? I did! Your companion rests their rough furred head on your shoulder before continuing. A whole lot of pretentious bores, but they do know how to throw a party. And it's always good to get out of that stuffy old boneyard. You watch city lights flash through tinted windows as James silently drives you onward. Ooh. Not really ghosting, though, is it? They chuckle at that. You're so old-fashioned. It's cute. And maybe James can find us a dimly lit park or something with some rowdy teens scare, eh? Come on, I'm serious. They sigh and sit upright. Maybe you have a point. You know, I usually don't have fun at these. Not really. I just break up the monotony. But I had fun tonight. I had fun with you. We could make this more long-term arrangement, if you'd like that. Bail. Then we really would ghost. I like this main person. Kiss them. And the question is an invitation, so you answer with an invitation of your own. You place a hand to cheek and lead in to kiss them. To be kissed, really. They're the one with lips, after all, and so a lean is all you can offer. You hang for a moment, tilted, and suddenly seized by doubt. Is this what they meant? What they really wanted? A moment later, you feel a softness of flesh, doubts dispelled. The fuzzy mane makes it clumsy, fumbling, ticklish. It's an awkward back and forth of bodies and biddings. You share laughs more than once as you embrace, ribs interlocking better than your mismatched faces ever could. Yeah, this is a good ending. Maybe the ghosting can wait for another night. The end. Ooh! We're all but bones and dust.
Man, I love it. I could spend another few hours trying to find all the endings on that one. Really, really good. Okay, it is 2:13. I think I was gonna go to probably three. We'll see how many more we get through. This one's Domino Jam entry number 13 by Susie Phoenix. Yeah, I want to know if you can get a tattoo. This was once a place of honor by Susie Phoenix. Link to the Domino Club. But longer ago than any of us could recall, we consider ourselves a powerful culture, basking in a code of light, neon and static. When it ended, we expected the light to fade with us. But summer still comes, its light echoing through our remains, the scars we left etched in concrete and carbon. Nothing is commemorated here but value. Let these monuments act as a warning. A system of messages, self-justifying propaganda. We exist as ghosts, weaving between the cairns, endlessly making pilgrimages towards poisonous routine. Ooh. Deluding ourselves that this is natural, that any of this was ever natural. The delusion is a danger to the body, and it can kill. At some point, this decays. We only can hope the poisoned ideology decays with it. I have to say, this is wonderful. The vibes are great. Maybe not having a cartoon jackalope over the top of it, reading it out, might help. This place is best shunned and left uninhabited. Uninhabited. Ooh. It's really good. Make sure there wasn't any branches, but this is very, very good. The actual like drawings on back, this is so good. Okay, I didn't think I missed anything, but yeah, this would be a great gallery exhibit, actually. This place is best shunned and left uninhabited. Very nice. Right. We are not halfway through yet, so we're probably going to do another day of this. Made by Mr. Style for Domino Club Jam, which may be my favorite pseudonym net yet. Wait, let me, can't stand quiet streams. I'm just thinking about the future. Ooh, good vibes. Oh, you think I could finish the rest? Hmm. A good vision of the future. Bad, 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 bad. Everything that is fun is bad for you, and everything that is good for you is boring. Sometimes stuff is just weird without a moral. I'm an optimist. I tell everyone I'm an optimist. I'm an optimist. Bad, bad, but this is not just a spat. Someone once told me that even when humans die out, the Earth will still be there, or when the Earth dies, space will still be there. I think they meant to cheer me, but I was too young. I'm still too young. Also, it's not like space exists in the same way we exist. Ooh, really good dialogue. Oh, okay. Going into the sky now. Okay, probably not supposed to fly into the sky, actually. Yeah, cerulean for tomorrow, definitely. That's it. Am I living in the future yet? I'm just thinking about the future. Ooh, this is cool. I always used to ask. That can't be it. That can't be it. That's it. Am I living in the future yet? Okay. So I totally skipped like half the dialogues just by kind of flying, but I want to see if I can go further. Nope. This is great. This is really good. Oh, I'm doing the whole picking up mode? No? Yeah, the language on this is really, really good. Yeah, the refraction's done super great. Yeah. So the vibes in Domino Club, all of these are fantastic. The dream sequences. Lightly fictionalized endless lockdown dream diary. Oh. By 9 or IX. Dreams from the year so far spent almost entirely in my apartment. Content warning. Some of the dreams have sexual content. Text only. Beep, beep, beep. Ooh, the low contrast art is a really interesting vibe. No bitsy porn that I've shared. I'm not saying that it doesn't exist. The dream sequences. Dreams from January through July 2021. You gotta go to the secret underground bitsy speakeasy for the bitsy porn. Thanks for playing. Beep, beep, beep. Oh, did I? Oh, I went back to bed. Whoops. Dream sequence number 1. A moralistic dream. Had a dream that someone took my author photo and for some reason I was happy with how it looked. The way you are only happy with the way you look in dreams. Except my hair was up in a weird bandana and messy bun combo that looked horrible. Which everyone was declining to comment on out of politeness. Oh, it's Pipsy! Yay! Dream sequence 2. A nihilistic dream. Had a dream. I started parting my hair like Susan Sontag. So I did, and it was amazing to me how it was something so simple that made me look a million times better. Which is also probably a revelation that she had at some point, which suddenly made beauty seem so trite. Dream sequence 3. An itchy dream. You get little hairs everywhere when you trim. I wipe them up, he protests. Off the sink, yes, but there's still bits on the counter and faucet knobs you miss. Fine, I'll get it. I return to the bedroom to dress and hear your footsteps briskly pacing into the bathroom, the light clicking on. I laid back on the bed in nothing but a still damp towel. I rolled my eyes back through layers of perception, down to the level where I could regard the absolute surface of my eyeball. My feeling was confirmed, floating across the tears and closing my left eye and beginning to poke painfully into the inner corner was a curved black bit of hair. There were other shards of crud, motes of dust. Sometimes I could even see the tip of a leg of a mite crawling along my lash line. Ew! Ugh! All clearly, all a bit too disgusting. People had always said my sensitivity was valuable. But this is a bit much. Toilet. Toilet. This one gets the toilet award. Shower? It's you! It's you! Toilet. Toilet. Other than being really hard to see, the art is so good here. Your partner's desk. Your partner's desk. Dream Sequence 4. Vampire Sex Dream.
Ooh.
I had an erotic vampire dream. A dream with you in it. Oop. You fell on the floor naked in a swoon. I missed that last. I picked up your squirming body, looked into your faraway eyes, felt where you were slick between your legs, and she saw me. Your blood was running down her face, and she looked like that girl who becomes a vampire in Francis Ford Coppola's Dracula, 1992. You know, that girl who starts out a bit weird and naive, and then gets sad, and then gets sick, and then turns into a vampire. All with a horrible, pale, gaunt face. Piled up high like a gothic cathedral, she had a huge strap on. So, the secret theme for the Domino games were strap-ons, like that part in the lair, the White Worm, 1976. Where the snake lady is about to use one to sacrifice a virgin, except it was more like a knobbly and shiny, huge ceramic, like the sculptures that the curator is really trying to buy, as a B-plot in Het Nieuwe. Can't say that. Rickmersham, 2008. I was scared. I felt doomed. I kind of wanted her to totally rail me, but she wanted you, and was going to have you. This is not a strap-on of honor. And you wanted her. I woke up feeling so wet and cramped up, like I was sure my period had started, but it hadn't. Okay, I got up with a groan and made myself a pot of coffee, and decided not to take a shower, and got on the computer. You were online, so I sent a message. Had an erotic vampire dream. Erotic vampire dream, LOL? LOL. Oh, that's realistic dialogue. Side table with some books. Armchair. Curtains. Dream Sequence 7. Rolling Eggs Dream. Dream Sequence 7 is my favorite of the dream sequence, especially when you get out of Midgard. I had a dream that to enter a house, I had to carefully roll an egg over uneven cobblestones under a low stone arch. It had almost passed all the way through safely, but my fingers were extending frantically, carefully, but frantically, to gently nudge it in the last few inches without it cracking. My shoulder ached in its socket, and I felt the lowness of arch against the point where my skull became too wide to slide under it. Ooh. I was fully extended. On the other side, you saw me valiantly struggling. You saw my scampering fingertips and the wobbling, delicate egg. And your response was immediate. You crouched down, and I saw your face peer across, your hand reach out, and carefully guiding the egg through, and then onto your own cupped hand. Our eyes met in opposite orientations as I strained. I smiled. Your fingertips may have brushed against mine. Or maybe it was just a languorous motion of dusty air. Knees crunching, I brought myself back up to full height and went around to the gate of the house to enter. It was lunchtime. From the smell and commotion of voices and metal against filled ceramic, I was rushed to a long table where I was seated across from you, but in the ruckus we couldn't talk to one another, only glancingly smile as we scooped potato salad from the heavy dishes and skewered cherry tomatoes and salad forks. Why is this dream the most sinister to me? But then something changed. Yeah, this is stress. Had I looked too aggressively? Committed some clumsy aberration of manners with the cutlery? Had the mayonnaise gone off? It seemed, my dear, that you went from a position where you couldn't speak to me to one where you wouldn't speak to me. I grew suspicious. What have you even done with the egg? Or I became doleful. Silly me, for my heart to skip a beat at such a thing, and I couldn't even begrudge you. Maybe you were so kind already that you simply thought nothing of how you had helped me. It was an action you performed as mechanically as zipping your fly. The feeling that I had made an irreversible mess of the situation was overwhelming. But I could go back. It was easy. I set myself outside of the house again, with the egg back into my hand. I began pushing it under the stone arch, eager to see you for the first time again. I told myself for a while, and desperate, even angled and lowered myself further to slide more of my head and shoulder into the claustrophobic space. I couldn't move. I felt at risk of being stuck, and my desperately extending fingers caused the egg to be pushed along its oblong side, rolling well out of my reach. The person who knelt to assist me in this case, hurrying along in his bumbling way, was not you, but a stubby-fingered wretch who smashed the egg against the edge of a cobblestone in his haste to pick it up. I felt like I could not pull my shoulders free. Enough! That was a rough dream right there. Eggs are the form demons take in dreams. Oh. Laundry folded in a pile on the couch. Laundry hanging on the radiator. This is where the front door would be if you had to leave, but you don't. Tall bookshelves filled. Compact kitchen. Dream sequence 5. A sex dream about Martin Gore. I had a dream I had to return your thigh-high stockings to you. They were stretched out and still warm from your calves, seemingly to float on my palm like a languid ghost. The band of elastic at the top had a black lace pattern, enclosing it. What a wonderful thing. Did you hand them to me because you thought they'd suit me better? I have to laugh. I'd hardly remember how to put them on, I think. You're always back in your leather jacket and tight black jeans. The sun is setting. I run across the field that stretches out and away from the gutted factory venue after you, and the nylon pulls against my clenched hands as I go. I catch up with you, pulling you down in the weeds, and I weave dandelion and daisies. Mr. Heavy Rain. Through your hair, my beautiful boy. My beautiful boy. Dream sequence 6. Shame dream. I had a dream I was begging for a haircut. My hair had gotten so long and thick. Please, it's like curtains. I would say, defeated, please, just do something with it. If a faceless barber would approach me and start snipping away at it, I would only feel guilty. It's so thick, I'm sorry, there's so much of it. You'll have to cut more. I don't even notice a difference. I'm sorry. It's never enough. It's never enough. I can't see their faces through the hair, but I feel the weight of their disdain. And my hair. Sleeping, warm and breathing softly. I think I have gotten everything, so the dream sequences. Beep, beep, beep. That's great. Ugh. Those are very, very good. I love everything. The low contrast was super interesting, actually. Not seen many like that. And yet another. There's this odd, like a kind of theme to these. Mother of Monsters is a game about abandoning community. Ooh. Oh, this was the Game Boy Studio one that I was really interested in. By T. Grandis. Mother of Monsters. Oh, this is good. Oh, wait. How do I interact? Credits start. Credits, obviously. A game by T. Grandis. Made for Domino Club. Domino Club. Yeah. Ooh. I'm standing in front of my mirror, my hair still wet from the shower. Delicately, I trace my figure, looking for a sign, for evidence, some kind of difference. I think it's there, but it's so hard to be sure. Hey, this fucking owns. I did not know you could do this with Game Boy Editor. Yeah, the Game Boy Studio is definitely makes me want to do more with it. I'm stepping out for a smoke. That's when I see her out on the balcony. Oh, that low crunch, graphic crunch cigarette, so good. I ask her for a lighter. She's got one. I offer a cigarette, but she declines. I don't smoke, she laughs. I'm tempted to ask her why she carries a lighter. Ask. She giggles. Well, you see, all the really hot trans girls, they all smoke. So by keeping this little thing on me, I have an easy excuse to chat up any cutie I see. Dot, dot, dot. I leave the cigarette on the railing. Never smoke with the eraser head, baby. She's looking at me knowingly, almost proud of herself. The truth is, she says, her expression more serious, you don't seem to be having much fun here. Everything okay? Nope. She pouts. I think I can help you out. I was in a similar spot. But this really helped me, and I think it could help you too, trust me. It might seem a little fucked up, but it beats whatever the hell you're doing. Definitely. Just rolling up the eraser head, baby, and taking a toke. She slips something into my pocket. Interesting. The cigarette is still here, smoldering. I think about her offer again. Part of me is disgusted, but I still can't deny that on some level, I want what she has. Ooh. Once again, I'm looking at myself, twisting and turning, desperate to find an angle that vindicates me. Fuck. This is fucking stupid. The key remains on my nightstand. It shimmers with a ruby gleam. I think about what she had told me that night. Could I really take her up on it? That night, as I was tossing and turning in my sleep, I had the strangest dream. Ooh, more cards. Interesting. I'm thinking this might be maybe a choice of directions to go. So let's try this. This is so cool. I have a nicer place now, so I thought it fitting to buy a bigger mirror. It seemed like a smart idea at the time, but to tell the truth, I don't really need it anymore. I don't spend much time looking at my body. I have what I want, I suppose. A car passes by soon after. I'm so startled by the noise that I forgot what I was doing in there. This is so cool. I really wanted to help at first. It was more than just doing the right thing. I wanted them around. I can't really explain it. So, you sought out their company. Oh, therapy chair. Yeah. It satisfied a social need. Nothing else did. When trust is taken and exploited, the tears of that grief do not evaporate, flowing into the earth, spiraling downwards from stalactites. The congealed droplets make their way. The stream carries them into Amois. Long before that cavern was inhabited, those tears built the area and grew the woods. Ooh. So many vibes. When I was young, maybe 13 or 14, I was walking in the city with my mother when a woman passed by us. I can't remember her face, only her very long blonde hair. This memory is incomplete. I can barely feel around at its edges. I wonder about how I got into this mess. I try to remember all this, all the other losers I know, the people I'd make fun of when I had friends, who sold out to some stupid grift, leaving their friends for power or to save face. Either they didn't know what they had gotten into, deluded themselves into thinking it was good, or they totally had given up, accepting they were perpetuating a con. Where does that leave me? Interesting. Past the arena, past the rooms, past the woods. There's a cliff overlooking the sea. The oldest of us, now too weak to be granted any boon. Also, I love that cliff, real good. Still fight there, repeating the same motions, as if they were still in Kidna's grace. Kidna, Mother of Monsters, I believe? Oh, right, that's the name. Game. Yeah. Another night, gleaming in the dark, the edge of reality that borders this place, woods of stone and silence. Oh, it's Knuckles. Ooh. Ooh, I didn't get all the way. Oh. Ooh. I'm going to have to play through this one a lot, actually. Ooh. In the back of my mind, an awareness grows. A vision of something else. Something far off. A premonition. ... I don't really blame anyone anymore. I wish it hadn't happened. That maybe, instead, I don't know. When I think about it, it sounds fucking stupid, but I wish we could have been sisters. That we could have supported each other or something, instead of this shit. She shuffles around on the bed. There's a great scar running down her thigh, which still hadn't fully healed. I'm down to do Sonic OCs, like, in a heartbeat. It still just sounds like it would have been nice, right? Well, it's a pretty idea to think about. Despite everything, I'm going to be okay. It's not very much, but it's a start, isn't it? Mother of Monsters. This fucking owns. Oh my god. This was so good. I'm gonna have to spend more time playing through this. And I honestly did not know you could do any of this with Game Boy Studio. So I am going to have to spend some time playing around with that, apparently. Card spread. Oh, I didn't realize it's not a game, it's a card spread. Oh, that's really good. So there's Get Naked. Friends still left. We're going to save Cerulean 3000 for tomorrow. Since I'm already going to be doing a stream tomorrow, I think I might actually end this now and pick it up and do the rest of them tomorrow. Just because doing a stream for 2 hours makes me anxious. But thanks everyone for stopping by. Those are some really, really good games we had to play. Got to play. I'll try to put this up on YouTube, although it might mute us because of the party. But these are so good. Thanks everyone for contributing to Domino Club. Yeah, these are astounding. Bye. Thanks for coming.